This has been a trying week for all Americans. As a country and as a people, we face trial and tribulation, elation, disappointment. We've asked ourselves many questions, and for some, the Pope arrived in the nick of time with all the right answers. But thank goodness, it's finally Friday. Welcome to Breakfast Tom with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer, it's me, Jillian. Now say good morning, Tom.
From high above Fifth Avenue overlooking Madison Square Park in the historic Flatiron District of New York, it's Friday's breakfast time, and we feel boombastic, baby fantastic! Woo! Yeah! Yeah! Friday, and that means it's time for color, everybody. Let's dig it into the 90s. Oh, this isn't Kansas anymore. You've made it to Friday. It's time for the Friday strut. Please welcome the lovely and talented Lori Hibbard.
Good morning.
You wait till I wear my heels someday.
You have like to this. Go up like that.
I know. Welcome to the Friday Strut, where we celebrate the week in review. We really do. We sort of like reflect on the week and can't wait for the weekend.
Indeed.
Get our little butts out of here right after the show. That's for sure. We're going to make sure everybody across the country struts. Now, I understand there's a problem in New Hampshire this morning.
There are always problems in New Hampshire. They got too much space, not enough people. We got a little bit of a problem with our satellite hookup, but John Davis is there, and I take it you're ready to strut on Mount Washington, right, John?
Yeah, Tom, we're getting ready to do the Hurricane Opal strut because we're experiencing what's left of Hurricane Opal. These good people are going to join us. Let's go.
All right, get us to
Mount Washington. Yeah, Mount Washington doesn't need a Hurricane Opal. They are very familiar with hurricane force winds there.
Yeah, absolutely. Upstairs on the third floor, we have Jane Fergus ready to do our news, but is she ready to strut?
Oh, yeah, the whole gang is. Whole staff of Breakfast Time that's up there on the third floor is ready, and we have the tandem bicycle strut, I believe, in Madison Square Park. We're going to take a look at tandem bikes later. Oh, look.
Yeah, they're ready.
they're peddling some new equipment to Mount Washington right now. Let's welcome everybody from the sidelines. The visiting Catcher Grannies. They join us from Millis, Mass. Come on in. You got to come in. You got to come in to strut. Behind us, we have Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks Orchestra. You have to strut, too. Put your instruments down.
Oh, good. I'm glad that
the guys who came, so this is bad timing in a sense, to take the chairs back that you're sitting on that we leased.
Oh.
Guys, we need them for one more show, but come in and strut with us while you're here. Everybody, chair movers. Come on in
Absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely.
This is an improvisational dance to celebrate the coming of the weekend, and today we dedicate it to viewer Teresa Kelly in Whitefish, Montana, at the foot of the Rocky Mountains.
All
in
right.
Whitefish, Montana.
Ready to strut?
All right, Robbie.
Rob.
Are you ready, laddie? Gentlemen, Vince Giordano, the first person since Tito Puente to play our kitchen.
All right.
Very nice. Very nice, Vince.
What a player he is.
Thank you.
Oh. That gets you going.
Got my mojo working here now.
good, because we got a terrific Pick Your News this
morning. Okay, I'm ready.
Okay. Pick Your News. Some glitch. Clock's ticking for Oprah, and Schneider's back.
Ticking for Oprah.
And Some glitch.
That's too intriguing. Some glitch.
Okay, good. Actually, good
choice.
Some
glitch.
You may have actually read this story. It was in the paper this morning, but I really got a kick out of it. A 14-year-old high schooler from New York City expecting $20 back from the New York Transit Authority because he lost $20 in a token machine trying to buy tokens. He gets a $20 check back, and then a week later, another check comes from the Transit Authority for $100,000.
Love that.
He's like, and he was, you know, I was like, well, what am I going to do? He'd love to cash it.
Is this a trick question?
No. He actually reported it, and, you know, they were hoping to get some sort of reward, because the guy wants to go to Harvard, and
sure.
It's pretty expensive and stuff. And they say, well, we really appreciate his honesty, but... You know, we're not the, whatever it is, the Ed McMahon sweepstakes.
How about a year's worth of free rides?
That would be good. Well, wouldn't that be nice or something?
Nice.
Yeah.
Can you imagine getting a $100,000 check? I would die. I would open it faint.
Yeah. Now, I think you should also go to the clock's ticking on Oprah, because this is the second big verdict of the week, at least to King World.
Sure, of course. You know, they're waiting in bated breath. Today is the day she has to decide whether she's going to do her show starting next year. I mean, there's been a lot of talk about how she's really tired of it.
Yeah.
She's done it for a lot of years. She wants to get out. But you know who's watching it more closely than anything is Wall Street, because her decision will drastically affect the King World stock.
King World has Oprah, they have what, Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune?
Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I don't want to say that's pretty much it,
that
but those are their biggies.
It,
yeah.
What else do they have?
Inside Edition?
They have Inside
Edition?
Edition
and American Journal, that's
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
And
let's
Rush Limbaugh,
way.
Let's not forget.
Let's
him.
Put it this way. If Deborah Norville says she's retiring, it's not going to impact them the same way.
No.
I don't think.
Oh, man, I watched Inside Edition last night,
mm-hmm.
and she slammed this piece. They came out of this piece. It was about people who were really involved in the O.J. Simpson case
yeah.
and really, you know, got into it, watched
groupies,
it every day.
Yeah,
what they're going to do afterwards. And this, you know, this old couple who'd been really watching it every day, and he goes, well, maybe we'll go back to watching Jeopardy. And that was the end of the piece, and she comes out, and she looks at the camera, she goes, or maybe you'll get a life. It was awful.
Yeah,
was, like,
I saw
wow.
that, yeah.
yeah. See, that's the Deborah Norville that Jane
yeah.
Pauley knows so well.
Yeah.
yeah. Since we saw you last time, the folks at the Cog Railway, where we got a crispy little shot earlier, on Mount Washington, their trains carried 10 tons of coal, and 10,000 gallons of water to make them go up and down the mountain 10 times. And there goes one now. And look at that much better video as we join John and Coltrane. John?
Hey, Tom. You know, Mount Washington here is known for some of the worst weather in the United States, but this is an especially bad day because... we're experiencing what's left of Hurricane Opal. It's blowing through here. But this Cog Railway, a train just like this, took its first trip up the mountain in 1869, and they still run the railway just the way they did back then. And what we're going to do is we're going to find out how they operate this incredible railway and take a little ride if we can.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're doing Dan Rather type reporting today.
I know. Where's a pole to hold on to?
and I didn't know John could do mime stuff. Look at that. Against the wind. Yeah.
John Davis to be joined by Auntie M later this morning. Across the street in Madison Square Park, we're going to take a look at tandem bikes, the single fastest growing part of the bicycle industry, and we've got a bicycle built for 10, just one of the several kinds of tandem bikes we'll take a look at. And later in our breakfast time link, this is something we've had conversations, right, Phil and Lori, so far this week. It's a musical breakfast time link as we use Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks and the wonders of the silent movie era to show you what a silent movie orchestra like Vince and his group are, what they can do to simple shots, the same shots
sure.
around the country in Mount Washington, New York, and Tucson. So
exciting.
That's coming up.
Yeah. All that coming up, but also I want to tell you, John was mentioning Hurricane Opal, which is now luckily Tropical Storm Oprah. Apparently, this is from the Hurricane Center, National Hurricane Center in Miami. They have run out of names, just about. They have two names left and 2 months.
We're up to P now, right? Pablo?
Yeah, they only pick 21 every year. And they're, because they don't use Q, U, X, Y, and Z. So they've got 2 months and two names left, so they're really nervous. They think they're going to run out of names, and they don't know what they're going to do.
Hurricane Xavier would be cool.
Yeah, I don't know why they don't use
Quincy?
Q, U, X, Y, and Z. If someone's watching.
Zamfir.
Yeah.
Well, it's already a win, so.
Yeah, it is.
But I think
it'd be
interesting if someone knows why they don't use those letters. They could fax us maybe at 212-802-4208 and tell us why.
Cool.
It'd be interesting. Right now, though, let's take a look at some of today's top stories.
No,
all right.
Good morning, everyone. Well, even though Hurricane Opal has lost steam, the numbers continue to rise. At least 17 deaths are now blamed on the storm, and damage estimates could reach $2 billion. It's the second most expensive storm in Florida's history. Hurricane Andrew is the first. It caused $17 billion in damage back in 1992. Well, Space Shuttle Columbia's mission was scrapped again this morning for the third time in about a week, but it wasn't because of Opal, as NASA had predicted. It was a problem with the shuttle's hydraulic system. NASA says they'll try again tomorrow. In some baseball news, the Cleveland Indians and New York Yankees can close out their American League playoffs on the road tonight. The Indians carry a 2-0 lead to Boston to face the Red Sox, and the Yanks, also ahead 2-0, take on the Mariners in Seattle. And finally, 60 Minutes commentator Andy Rooney is putting his money where his mouth is. Rooney says he'll offer $1 million to anyone who finds the killer of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman. That's a quick look at what's making news. Jillian, what's going on with the weather?
Well, in New England, Jane, New England area, that meaning New York and New Hampshire, where John Davis is, Maine, there's partial clearing. It'll be warm and humid elsewhere. Before this morning time, there is going to be those rain and some clouds. But on the west coast near Washington, northern Idaho, it's also partly cloudy with scattered showers, mainly in western Washington. Let's go to some of the high temperatures. New York, it's actually going to turn out to be a pretty hot day. It's Indian summer. We're going to see some low 80s in New York. In Miami, down in Florida, where they've had some problems, it's going to be 92 degrees. 92 degrees in Miami. But basically, it looks like it's going to be clearing throughout the country and warming up for the weekend.
We have got the Catcher Grannies. They have come to get free food from us.
From Millis, Massachusetts. Actually, it was Al and Barbara who initially wrote us, and our viewers. This is Barbara here. And Al, and you wrote a letter because you've been watching the show and you wanted to see Defending the Caveman.
Yeah, from on the show, and we saw your interview, and we came
Rob
up to
Becker
visited.
Was here at the start of that. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And we came up to visit my uncle and aunt, and we came in and saw the show, and it was great.
Yeah, you enjoyed it?
Oh, it was fantastic. Laughed every minute.
Now, this is Uncle Tony and Aunt Charlotte.
Right.
And you guys have seen the show by videotape, right?
Yes, we have. He's
yeah.
just,
and you
still
are from,
to come.
You're from Dayton, New Jersey.
Yes. Yeah.
Dayton, New Jersey.
And you come to us after having seen the Pope yesterday, right?
Yeah.
Did you ask the Pope to join us?
I tried, but I couldn't meet him here.
All right. Now, I want to just applaud your fashion choice, if you would stand with me.
Brother.
Just for a second.
Wow.
Al from Millis, huh?
This isn't helping in our quest to get him to change his style, you know?
Look, an outfit from the House of Tom.
Nice work, Al.
You're welcome.
We'll have to see you trying to change your outfit the other day. I figured I had it resurrected. We keep it going.
That's right. Yeah.
Self-fulfulfilling prophecy. We're good. Have some,
for Peter Pan's all across the world.
Can you guys say smoking or non-smoking?
Jillian, if other people want to dress really nice and join us for breakfast, how do they do that?
Well, they can write to us, Tom, at breakfast time, P.O. Box 825, Madison Square Station, New York, New York, 10159-0825. Or they can ring us at breakfast time, telephone 800-FX-FX-FX-1, and that's sponsored by Sprint. They can also email us and fax us. Fax us first at 212-802-4208 or email at ethicsbreakfast@delphi.com.
Did you hear that? He had a special request.
Oh.
One of the only shows, Gwen McGee's here, one of our road warriors, one of the only shows that Uncle Tony and Aunt Charlotte have seen was the one with you and the llamas. At the state fair, where you did the cartwheel, and so what was just requested by Al, could you do a little cartwheel, just right here?
Yeah,
you know. Come on, Gwen.
Careful on your heels.
So this was a classic breakfast time.
Oh, do an entire gymnastics routine.
Yeah.
We're lucky we didn't ask you that when Mario Van Peebles was here. Dying of embarrassment. Jillian, what's coming up on the show?
Coming up is Phil Kogan. He's going to teach us how our toilet bowls and our showers and the sinks in our bathrooms can be less wasteful. Coming up on Breakfast Time. It's 17 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Lori, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer, it's me, Jillian. Now here's Lori and Tom.
Now, I just want to tell you, Mr. Lori, and everybody else watching it, today, later in the show, we're going to have some of Sheena's Dad Home Country.
the walk is everything.
Oh,
you got to get
man.
The walk.
That's the last time I ride a tandem bike.
Yeah. We're heading down to the bathroom to talk to Phil Kogan because he is our energy specialist. Last week he taught us how to save energy in the kitchen. You know, your energy bill usually goes up in the fall and more so in the wintertime. Last week it was the kitchen, this week the bathroom. Hello, Phil.
Oh, hi. I'm sorry. I'm not otherwise occupied. No, I wanted to joke about how you could save energy in the bathroom because, like you said, I showed you ways you could do it in the kitchen, and we do use a lot more energy in full because we're starting to put on heaters and that sort of thing, and we're having more showers, that sort of thing. So let's start with the head or the toilet, as you would say. Now, just put this down here.
Is the lid up or down?
Down.
The lid is down at this stage. All right, now, most toilets use 3.5 gallons of water every time they flush.
Flush, right.
And one of the things you can do is you can get the two-flush system installed. A lot of people in California have those, so that depending on how
what
you go
you
to
do,
the bathroom,
right.
You can use less water. And they only use 1 gallon of water. Now, that's, you know, a bit of an expense. If you don't want to go to the expense, what you can do is take a brick or a container of water like this.
And
Just displace the water, put that in there. And that'll obviously save you having to put one of those systems in.
Or
the other
thing
is,
that's
right.
Yeah.
A six-pack
will work. And you can keep it cool at the same time.
Exactly. You never know when you might need one. Now this little floater right here. On most modern toilets, you can adjust that floater and you can adjust the amount of water that comes into the toilet. So now one more thing I want to show you here, and we're going to lift the toilet seat up for this one, Bob. Leaks are a big problem, and you want to find out if you have a leak. Take some red food dye.
Ask Nixon.
Without flushing, put this into into the fill right here.
Yeah.
And if, after waiting a wee while, the red dye goes down into the bowl of the toilet, you've got a leak and you've got to get seen to. That means that water's leaking down into the bowl and you might want to get a plumber.
Right. Also, just one thing. Alexander Paul from Baywatch was here, and I think it was her who had the 3P rule. You have to go 3 times before you're allowed to flush. And that's a good one.
It depends whether you're eating asparagus, I suppose.
Also, knock 3 times on the window if you want me.
That's right. Now, another thing you want to do with toilet rolls is when you get them and you put them on the toilet
was
roll,
that Dawn?
Squeeze them like this. That way, when they're on the roll right here, and you pull them, they won't just sort of roll out everywhere.
Oh, okay.
It stops them from rolling out.
It's tougher to get more, so you don't use as much.
When you go to the supermarket, have a look to see if you can get the recycled toilet paper. Not recycled toilet paper, sorry. Recycled paper that's been made into toilet paper.
Right, okay.
Right? It's sometimes a few cents expensive.
And it's not as soft, but you're doing something good for the environment.
Well, you can get soft ones.
Oh.
All right, let's go into the shower here, because there's a couple of ways you can save water in the shower. First of all, get a shower head like this one right here. This uses 40% less water, and there's some that use actually 70% less, but it's 40% is better because
it's still a strong head?
Still a strong stream? Yeah, because it forces the water out there, you still get a nice shed. The other good thing to do is to shower with a good friend, because that way you can save water.
Move on.
No, true. I'm being serious.
And you don't have a friend that good.
To take shorter showers, because a lot of people go in there and they start contemplating the world in the shower, and the water is, you know, going out there.
Right. And showers instead of baths, I would guess.
Right. If you're going to, if you have a leak, use a bowl like this to collect all the excess water. You can use it on your plants until you get a plumber in to fix it.
Good idea.
If you're doing your drying, not a lot of people know this. This is a good one. When you're doing your drying, get some dry towels, throw them into the dryer with your wet washing, and then put your dryer on. What this does is it actually absorbs all the excess water,
cool,
and it'll save you a lot of money.
That's a great tip.
Yeah, what a good idea.
That's a very good one.
One final one with the tap.
When people start brushing their teeth, they turn the water on. They start with the toothbrush thing. They go over and they watch TV and they start brushing around. They leave the water going.
Right.
They come back and do a little thing. Make sure when you're finished with it, just turn it off.
Right.
And one final point, when you wash your face, do it with cold water instead of hot water because first of all, it's better for your skin. Second of all, you don't use the excess hot water, and it will wake you up if you do it in the morning.
Good tip. And some great tips, Phil. Thank you very much. How to save energy in the bathroom.
Ow.
Mr. Phil Kogan, our special echo guy this morning. As always, actually. Not special.
Thanks, Lori. Hey, our bathroom has something that some hotels have as well, and that is a phone right by the toilet. And I call me crazy, but that to me indicates a level of being blasé that I'll never achieve. I'll just never get there. Right now, we're going to have a level of philosophy that we achieve daily with Bob Keeshan, Captain Kangaroo. Bob.
Hey, Mother and Dad, think about this today with your young people. You give but little when you give of your possessions. It is when you give of yourself that you really give.
They need food.
That's a good one.
Oh, that's a good one. Well said, Bob. Jill, what's coming up on the show?
Well, the first mountain climbing railway in America, Lori. The little train that could and has since 1894. Coming up on Breakfast. It's 26 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer, it's me, Jillian. Now here's Tom, Lori, and the gang.
You're listening to the music of Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks. And they're going to score some classic silent movies for us later today. Keep going. I want to walk to this.
Thank you.
Look, they almost all stopped together. Oh, wow.
Almost.
That's right. That's great stuff. And they're going to, again, score some silent movies. A Buster Keaton scene from Sherlock Jr. on this, the week of his 100th birthday. He would have been 100 this week. He also was a big one for trains. You remember Steamboat Bill Jr.? That's the right title, isn't it, Bob?
General. I couldn't hear you down here.
Ah, there is a God. let's go to Mount Washington, New Hampshire. J.D. is with the folks that take the train up the mountain about 10 times a day, weather permitting. John?
Yeah, and today's not one of those days, Tom. Dan Rather here, live from Mount Washington. As I said earlier, there are winds blowing from Hurricane Opal. They have gusts at about 65, 70 miles an hour, so we're going to do our best here. But look at this. This is one of the trains here at the Mount Washington Cog Railway. And the first trip that went up the railway was in 1869.
Oh,
and right after the railway was built, President Ulysses S. Grant jumped on the train and went up the mountain.
I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow him right down.
And I'll blow him. And this is Kathy. And Kathy's one of the co-owners here, and she's out here in this craziness with us. How are you, Kathy?
I'm just fine. You're standing up very well.
I know. We're planting our feet. All right. This is a steam engine, or a coal engine. It obviously produces steam and operates on steam. But explain the cog element of the railway.
The uniqueness of this train is that it does not use regular tracks to motivate itself. It uses actually a cog gear.
I'm
look under the train there and you'll notice that there is actually a wheel. It's like your watch. It is a cog gear that goes into the rack that you can see. The locomotive actually provides the power, and the rack and the cog wheel pulls the locomotive up the train.
And there aren't many of these in the world. There's one in Colorado, one here, and a couple in Switzerland, correct?
That's correct. And this particular cog railway is the only one that is all coal-fired steam. It's all coal.
Okay, this is Bob up here. And come on up here, Bob. And Bob's going to explain that to get this bad boy going, you don't just flip a switch. You have a lot of work to do. Let me go over on the other side. And we'll meet up with Bob here.
We're losing you, John.
Hello, Bob. Do you hear me now?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, Bob. There's a lot to do to get this thing going. In a nutshell, what are some of your checkpoints that you need before you can take off?
First thing in the morning, what we do is knock over a bank to get the hot coals, if you notice that right now.
Over
then
a bank?
Knock
water,
over a bank?
Make sure we have water.
Is it Dillinger Railroad?
You knock off a bank?
Yeah. And then what we do is just look at the gauge up here.
What's the pressure have to be?
About 175 pounds.
I can't handle that pressure.
Then we just turn the blower on right here, if you can hear that, to generate air to generate steam.
And then this is the coal bin. Now, how much coal do you use to get up the mountain and
coal
back?
Train.
We use 1 ton of coal only on the way up, and it's hand shoveled by one person.
Wow, 1 ton on the way up, and it's hand shoveled.
All the way up, yeah. We don't use coal on the way down because we just gravity on the way down, so we don't need steam pressure.
Okay, and how old is this particular train?
This was originally built in 1909. It was refurnished back 3 years ago.
Okay, let's take a look at it. Let's hop up. Don't you have to blow the horn when you're... There we go. Now let's take a look at this. Obviously, they've updated the railroad They've done some different things, but it still operated exactly the way that it was operated in 1869. Now tell us about the switching system. This is a manual switching system, right?
Absolutely. There are 9 separate movements for this particular switch, and it's so important because you're not only moving the 2 rails, but you're also moving the actual rack in the center so that the cog gear will actually move from one train line to the other.
And look at this. This guy is physically moving the rails, as opposed to just hitting a switch like they do on modern railways. They physically have to move the rails together, and you have 9 specific things you have to do, or this bad boy could derail, right?
Absolutely. It's very important that every one of these things move over and up to move the whole paraphernalia from one side to the next.
Okay, let's get this thing, let's get it going, and
move that bad boy.
The trip, you go to the summit, it's 6,300 feet. And although this weather is not conducive to taking a ride up, we're going to do it anyway.
But
you know, we shouldn't be doing TV in this weather either.
Are you really going up?
Yeah.
Oh.
A little way, Tom, okay. Just to show you what the ride's like.
The John Davis
Come on,
farewell
are you coming
tour.
Up? Come on.
There's
so that's
Joe,
a look at the Cog Railway here at Mount Washington.
Hey! All right, get our last good look at them whole.
Yeah.
as they head up Mount Washington. This is our second windy day in a row. Yesterday, Phil Kogan at Staten Island's, the world's largest landfill. Yeah. The wind was kicking up quite a storm there, too.
I do. You're the nice warm environment watching us out there.
Yeah,
and we do a kite segment, we get nothing.
That is the truth. All right, thanks, J.D. Lori?
Yeah, we have Mario Van Peebles joining us.
Yeah.
Morning.
Yeah.
Glad to have you here.
Good to be here.
He's here.
All right.
Meet the gang. This is Bob.
Yo.
Hey, Bob,
Yo.
What's happening, man?
High five.
Hey.
High five. Slap the face.
Yeah. More with Mario and his film Panther coming up right now. The Let's Take a Look at Some of Today's Top Stories. Thanks, Lori. I'm Jane Fergus with Breakfast Time News. Pope John Paul is at Aqueduct Racetrack in New York this morning. He's leading another outdoor mass. In New Jersey last night, the pontiff celebrated mass in the driving rain at Giant Stadium with a record 83,000 people. Well, firefighters in Northern California say they could use some driving rain. They've been working since Tuesday to get several wildfires under control. So far, those fires have destroyed more than 11,000 acres and dozens of homes along the Northern California coast. And finally, it could be the longest kiss in music history. Seal's Kiss from a Rose is the number one single on the Billboard chart for the 8th week in a row. That's a quick look at what's making news. Now here's Jillian with the weather.
Well, Jane, in eastern New Mexico, Oklahoma, and Texas, it's mostly sunny, breezy, with morning showers in the east. But in Georgia and the Carolinas, Virginia, showers possible, thunderstorms on the plains, and muggy. Let's take a look at some of those high temperatures. There they are. Well, we're going to see some 70s in Cincinnati, in Indianapolis. It's also going to be in the 70s. On the west coast down there in the southwest, it's a little bit warmer. We're seeing some 80s and 80s creeping up there along the Florida coast, 80s all along the coast there along the Atlantic. So it looks like it's going to be a beautiful weekend.
Yay.
Thank you very much, Jill.
Yay.
Nice work down there. Let's have a little mailbag music, please.
All right. Nope.
Now that Mario's here, do
Billy Vanilli.
Hey, Mario.
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey.
Yeah, that's right.
9.9, 9.8.
Let's sit on the old casting couch. Come over here.
Yeah, I'll swap with you. All right.
Hey. Okay, we got a.
You guys didn't hear Jillian. 9.3, 9.8.
Very nice, Jill.
Hey, Jillian.
Patrick Smith of Charlotte, North Carolina wrote us, I was wondering who the people strutting with Jane up in the newsroom were. Just asking. Actually, up on our third floor, we have a camera up there now. Jane Fergus does the news. And behind her, during the strut, we get everybody else, all the FXs, all the breakfast timers.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nobody there now.
well, there. You know who is here, though? My news writer, Lucy. Oh, Lucy, do you think that?
Lucy,
do you like getting strutted?
Oh, of course. Love it.
We've got a lot of news writing to do.
Yeah, actually, all the other people behind her are people, segment producers and associate producers, people who actually put Breakfast Time together.
Hey, Martin.
Well, it's so funny. Jason Stratt, they all get
Cookie,
up on the wall.
Up.
I mean, it's like a table dance.
They jump up.
With Archipelli.
Yeah. It's fun, though. It gets us, you know, kicked off for the news all morning.
You know what they're really doing? Making long-distance calls to friends.
Hey, who are you talking to, Tracy?
Hey, Don Fox.
Yeah, the working jerks are down there. Let's make those calls.
Sarah Shetler from Mesa, Arizona writes, I love Breakfast Time. My concern is for the Road Warriors. My questions are, who decides where they go? J.D.'s case in point today in the wind-whipped Mount Washington. Why are the assignments so dangerous? John has been with poisonous snakes. Spencer has been in underwater caves. And last Monday, Phil Kogan was in Portland, Oregon with a bunch of crazy people and their designer beater cars. I'm not complaining, just concerned. Are you guys equally worrisome about these trips we send you on?
It's part of a parole agreement we have with the court.
Terrible. Oh, we love it.
Yeah.
We better love it. Yeah. We have to go out and do it.
It's your job. The only thing that I just can't do is like heights. I got a terrible fear of heights. But other than that, anything goes, you know.
Okay.
Cartwheel
was very good.
Yeah.
Very good. Did you want
very
to?
Good.
Yeah, oh, yes. P.S. There's a P.S. here. P.S. I love everyone, but I think Lori is the only sane person there.
The only sane person?
And you shouldn't have to put up with Tom and Bob when they become too much. What is the difference between sex and an omelet?
He's making stuff up now.
That's not true.
Want to have breakfast?
Wait, I think we better feed Mario.
Yeah. Feed Mario.
Apparently he has issues. If we reach a letter on the air, we will send you an FX t-shirt in the mail, and Jillian's going to tell you how to write and fax them.
Well, write to us, Lori, at P.O. Box 825, Madison Square Station, New York, New York, 10159-0825. Call us at 800-FX-FX-FX-1, sponsored by Sprint. Fax us at 212-802-4208 and email us fbestbreakfast@delphi.com.
Pretty close, right?
Are you hungry, Mario?
I am.
Do you want some breakfast?
I think they're making me
really fresh toast, scrambled eggs.
Are we feeding Beth Howard from Self Magazine, who's visiting as well? Beth, do you want something more substantial? Do you want something for your inner self? We have Sheena, our shrink here.
I'll take waffles with
waffles for 20.
Blueberry syrup, a little ice cream on the
Yeah, well, you're going to get tofu and sprouts.
All right.
I'll have to leave.
I'm going tandem biking. Yeah. I'll be back. See you later.
And we have more with Mario the People's coming up. So stay where you are, Jill.
Yes, a bicycle built for 10. And actor-director Mario Van Peebles comes to the apartment with a movie and a message when we come back. It's 19 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer is me, Jillian. And now, here's lovely Lori.
Thank you, Tommy. Tommy, give me your answer true. Of course, that was for a bicycle built for 2. 10, I'm not sure about, but Tom's in the park with a gentleman who has built that exact thing, isn't he?
It's incredible. We're going to show you the more customary tandem bikes, which, by the way, we mentioned earlier, Lori, tandem bikes, the fastest growing part of the bicycle business, curiously. Richard Newman from Toga Bikes in New York is back with us. Richard, good to see you again.
Hi, John. Nice to see you.
Let's deal with bicycle built for 2. We've got some of our road warriors on them. And what do you think explains the growing fascination with tandem bikes?
Well, I think one of the things that's happening is that people want a lot more people exercising, men and women, and this is a way for people to exercise together, particularly if you're on any unequal abilities and you want to go out and do something together. You don't always have to do it separate. So you get on a tandem and you're working out together. It's, it's fun, it's interesting, it's something novel to do.
Who's doing the most work here on this particular
tandem bike? This would be the most inexpensive tandem you could get, okay? Yeah. And this bike, they're working equally, all right? Except the guy in the front.
Do you
front,
believe that?
Oh, I think I do more work.
Well, he's usually, that position is called the stoker, but this guy's doing a little work because he's doing the steering and he has the handbrake. On this bike, you also have a foot coaster brake.
Yeah.
If you pedal backwards, all right, it'll stop.
Now, is this next tandem bike different in that regard? I mean, does one person get more of the workload on this one?
Well, no, it's the same sort of thing, except this bike is much more of a traditional bike.
It's a racing bike, too.
It's got lots of gears. It's got regular cantilever brakes and no reverse foot brakes, coaster brakes.
Now, do you think she's seeing your best side?
Oh, yes, she is, definitely.
Yeah. Tommy, you have just touched on one of the disadvantages of Canada. There's a guy in the back, or the woman in the back doesn't always have the best view.
Uh-huh.
On the other hand, if there's wind or rain coming at you, they've got shelter. So they'd be a happy.
Now, what about this one over here?
All right, well, you know mountain biking is very popular.
Yeah.
All right, and this is now a logical extension, a mountain tandem, okay? It's a little bit heavier duty built, okay? It's got a suspension seat post and a suspension fork in the front. It's got a suspension seat post in the back because the guy in the back tends to get bounced around a little. I want to say one other thing quickly.
Yes.
These models don't have helmets on, but if you're going riding, if you don't wear a helmet, you're really asking for a problem. This is just way too important to leave out.
You know, it's interesting. In the 1990s, these are being marketed and sold quite briskly now for fitness-related reasons. When they were first developed, they were developed so that women could ride alone.
Well, we know that women wouldn't accept that anymore.
Oh,
I want to talk about one other thing about tandems. People who are blind or some other way handicapped or challenged, can go out and enjoy the pleasure and the exercise of riding because they can be on the back pedaling and feeling the wind through their hair on their face.
I know Stevie Wonder is among the celebrities who,
well, there are a number of people
blind who's gotten one of these. Now, here it is. This is incredible. How many of these are there?
This is the only one in the world.
Only one.
We built it. It is unique.
Person tandem bike. In the middle, we have the Catcher Grannies from Millis, Mass. And Dayton, New Jersey, our visiting family, and they are bookended by road warriors. You ready to, as John Davis would say, take that bad boy around the park?
Jump up on the seat. Wait, we're on the seat. Just get on
you
the
gotta
seat.
Get up on the seat. Yeah, everybody on your seat.
Okay, let's go. Away
they go. I'm betting on the third guy.
Look at this.
Wow.
Yeah. Hey, they don't all have helmets. That's a darn good point.
Well, yeah.
Look out, she's going over.
So as you can see, these are good for those short trips with 10 people. very nice. Rich Newman from Toga Bikes in New York.
Thanks, Tom.
It's a pleasure to see you always.
Yeah.
The tandem bike. Lori?
Thank you very much. You know, Tom, you never know how some guests are going to react to the fact that we like to serve breakfast. Mario Van Peebles insists on breakfast in bed. With a flower and everything like that. He's here to talk about the release of his movie Panther on video on October 17th, right?
Isn't this didn't forget the mints, did
great.
You?
This is great.
No one told you about this part,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, but will you still respect me in the morning?
Absolutely. No. As much as I respect you now, because you can carry a tray into you. Mm. So we're going to take a look at a clip of Panther. We'll come back and talk all about it, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is this a militant action? Are the Panthers storming the Capitol?
Absolutely not. We need to send a message. The Black Panther Party for Self-Defense calls upon the American people in general, and black people in particular, take careful note of the racist California legislature now considering the mall for that. It's aimed to keep black people disarmed and powerless, but a racist police agency throughout this country intensify the terror, brutality, murder, and repression of black people. Now, I got a question for you. Where's the State Assembly?
Well, it's right up there on the second floor, sir.
All right, good man. All power to the people.
Oh, you know, yeah. I'll tell you.
That looks like a brilliant film.
I'll tell you, it was a great film to watch last night.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, I was very inspired by it, especially with what, you know, we've been going through the past few days in our country.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because there's so much we didn't know about the Panthers in that whole time that you were just told one thing. Most people think scary guys, scary guns.
Now, your dad wrote the book originally.
My dad wrote the book. And,
what made him write it in the first place? Did he just want to tell
You know what happened was, in between French toast, what happened was my dad did a movie in 1971 called Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song. And it was about a street guy who becomes a revolutionary. And the Panthers fell in love with the movie because they were trying to get, you know, gang guys and people from the street to start thinking politically and put down, you know, start voting and getting into education, and they start a free breakfast program. Hey, that's appropriate.
Hey,
right?
We have that here.
We have that here. And,
excuse me, I'm sorry to interrupt, but you have a price tag.
Oh, a price tag.
Shoe.
Well, now we know what her shoes cost.
Right here. We'll just take it. We'll take care of it.
Shoe.
Yeah, there's a price tag on his blouse as well.
There actually is.
Can you have this removed, please?
Oh, that's so embarrassing. That's the third day in a row, which is why they had to stop the interview. Oh. The third day in a row that the bottom...
And there's a hole in your sock, too.
Anyway, I'm sorry to interrupt.
So what happened was, my dad's movie Sweetback came out. The Panthers write about the movie in their paper, and they write about this little scruffy head kid that's in the movie. Which turns out to be me.
Yeah.
And Huey said that this kid sort of symbolizes the future. And 20 to 30 years later, here I am directing the movie
about it. Why didn't you put yourself in the movie?
Well, you know, we had people like Angela Bassett and Jodan Baker in little roles. And my ego is not in you know, being in the movie more, seeing,
right.
you know, 90 more close-ups of Mario. So I just wanted to lay back on this one and direct it. I'm in it just for a cameo. And plus, I'm very difficult to work with. I'll never work with myself.
You never work with yourself. You're very hard to direct. Take no direction. I thought you had great vision casting Kadeem Hardison in the role of Judge. Yeah. I really did, because everyone sees him as Dwayne Wayne.
Right.
And,
right.
I mean, for you to look beyond that and see that he could do this role is really great.
I've known him since he was a kid.
Really?
Yeah, and he's a good guy. He's a good. But this was fun because we had so many people. When we first went to Hollywood to do the Black Panthers, right? They asked us if we could make one of the lead guys, like lead Panthers white. Tom Cruise.
Oh, you gotta be joking.
No, that's what they said. And they said, look, you know, Mississippi Burning, we didn't feature Dr. Martin Luther King, we featured, you know, William Dafoe and Gene Hackman, and we know boxers look more like Ali, we make him look like, you know, Stallone, and
right.
and Dances with Wolves would have been a more
that
Indian.
That sells.
We didn't do it.
I'm glad you stuck to your guns.
And it's really been exciting because people found the movie, and especially now it's coming out as video. It's been,
yeah. Now, what do you think about what's been happening the past few days with the O.J. verdict and all that?
Well, you know, I think that it, the unfortunate thing is it shows that the country is still divided on a lot of issues.
Yeah.
And I think it's very hard for people who have never been exposed to the hood or the ghetto to believe there is really a kind of other treatment that people get. That's very difficult.
You're right. It is hard to believe.
If you just go, oh, come on.
Come on.
Whining.
In the 90s,
you just can't believe. So what happens is when you see that kind of Furman mentality, that what do you do when the gang wears blue mentality, you guys watch it and think that's the exception to the rule.
Yeah.
Other people watch it and go, we know
see,
that goes on
rule.
A lot. And that's what the Panthers were dealing with. Interesting, the social conditions that brought the Panthers into existence are coming back now. Because, if, for example, I was listening to one of those right-wing radio stations. The lady was complaining. She says, my husband's a police officer. He's white. He got higher scores than this Mexican cop. But they'll hire the Mexican cop first because of quotas. But studies show if you don't have some Spanish cops in Spanish neighborhoods, you get they don't treat them like people.
Yeah.
So if I'm in a Spanish neighborhood, I'm a cop, I'd like to have a Mexican cop as my partner. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's very important that America has a balance. And some of these things help preserve it, and they, you know, and some don't. And it's the French say, le plus ça change, le plus ça reste le même. The more things change, the more
they
stay the same.
You're right.
This is one of those movies to check
out. It's truly inspirational. It really is. Panther comes out on video October 17th. I highly suggest you check it out and pick it up at your local video store. I'm going to leave you to your breakfast.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you
and
for coming on the show. Merry about people.
Thank you very much.
Everybody.
Hey. Bon appétit.
And just a word for Lori, Tom, before you go to
sure.
Jillian in the booth.
Yep.
We want to give credit where credit's due, and that video is from Polygram Video.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Polygram.
We go from discussions multicultural to discussions extraterrestrial when we come back with Janice Kaplan, senior editor of TV Guide, and we look at sci-fi TV. What else, Jill?
Silent Film Orchestra, Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks accompany us for our breakfast time link from New York to Arizona when we come back. 8 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the announcer, it's me, Jillian. And now here's Tom.
Yeah, and across the hall, in bed still, with Mario Van Peebles, is Lori. Jillian had asked me yesterday, I don't know, Mario, this is up to you.
Yeah.
We take a shot of Jillian. This may answer the question.
He should be in that
Take a shot of Jillian. You don't have a camera in there?
No, it doesn't
Picture a very attractive young woman who would really love for you to come down to this isolated booth that we've put her in for the entire show just to say hi.
A woman in an isolated booth.
Oh, you gotta go. She's really sweet. You gotta
go. That sounds interesting.
Sounds like a Ricky Lake scene.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
It's like,
think you're in, Jill.
I think it was a great intention, but how you did it, we'll talk later.
Mario, you're gonna thank us.
Okay.
Janice Kaplan is here, senior editor of TV Guide. We're going to talk about all the sci-fi stuff,
right.
But I just find out that she interviewed Fergie.
You interviewed recently. Sarah Ferguson?
What?
A secret.
No, no,
God,
no
you
secret.
Can't tell anything on this show.
Secret.
The question I'm wondering about is why does Mario get breakfast and juice and French toast and I get water?
Because you're not going to talk about Fergie.
Let them eat.
But in 2 weeks.
So
I will.
You will?
In 2 weeks, I will. Come back and tell you everything I know.
Who did
That's
you mention this
big.
To? Because it got, it, you didn't Ooh. Tell me. It got through
that
a loop.
Fast. It got through real a loop. Fast.
All right, well, all right, don't tell me what you talked about. Where'd you meet her?
I met her in her house in Surrey, England.
Wow. Oh, really?
Yeah.
In her house. And I'm not going to tell you about that either.
Yeah.
Let's talk about sci-fi.
Did you talk for a long period of time
Didn't
with her?
Didn't I just say I was going to talk about this in 2 weeks?
Yeah, 2 weeks. Let's fly her with bagels or something. Give this woman an egg.
Little French toast would be nice.
All right. Now, you know, another thing, can you bring the whole issue? I mean, what's this? What's this TV guide to most people?
I guess the show can't afford the 89 cents to go out and buy them, huh? Or maybe we're up to 99 cents now, forgive me.
The cover story.
That explains it.
The cover story here, for this is the current newsstand edition. Yeah, that's right, see.
In the newsstand, you get the listings, too. You just get the first 10 pages.
On Deep Space Nine, they've got Worf from The Next Generation coming back, and that's making some news for Star Trek fans. But let's talk about some new sci-fi related shows.
Everyone's doing sci-fi.
Mm-hmm.
There's all different kinds of sci-fi on right now, and one of the real interesting ones is on Fox. It's called Space Above and Beyond, and it's sort of a next generation Star Trek. The producers of it say it's not sci-fi, it's a military drama set in the future.
Yeah.
I understand that's very different.
That's like
I'm not
saying,
sure how.
I'm not that, I'm just drawn that way. and they're putting a lot of money into this. Let's take a look at a clip, about $2 million an episode,
absolutely,
which is more than even Star Trek shows.
More than this show gets.
All right, well, no kidding.
Yeah.
No kidding. Let's take a look at a clip, if we can.
Hawk is breaking formation.
What is he doing? I don't know, he's not responding.
Answer me, Hawk!
Very Star Wars, Top Gun kind of thing.
Lots of good action, lots of good special effects. And what I really like about this show, and what I think sort of sets apart a show like this, is that the characters, this guy you see here, some of the others, the characters are real good. There are good relationships that go on. There's sort of a whole undercurrent of relationships and issues like that that are happening. It makes it more than just intergalactic space travel.
I understand, and I think you told this to Fergie. the violence concerns you a little bit.
Yeah, there's a little more. I was watching this with one of my kids, and I kept saying, well, why don't you go get Mom a glass of water?
Okay.
That's all I get.
Let's go to... you talk, you eat. Let's take a look at a clip from Nowhere Man, which follows Star Trek Voyager on the United Paramount Network.
Right.
Nowhere to go. They'll find you.
It's L.A. Law?
Yeah.
They. And who are they, Doctor? Or is this just the raving of a paranoid lunatic? You have no idea what you're up against. Then tell me.
I love this show,
Thanks.
The premise. This is a photographer who's tied up our friend from L.A. Law there, and he apparently took one picture too many.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And his identity has been completely lost.
That's your
And it's sort of
problem.
Like the fugitive. He has to go
Didn't
off, well, he's not in search of the guy who killed his wife. He's in search of his own identity and who he is and who's in the plot.
But all the people whom he loves and knows are denying that they know him.
Nobody knows who he is,
including
and
his
we
wife.
Don't know why. We don't all know
right.
if it's a conspiracy. We don't know if he's crazy. What's going on? It's
you like
a
that one?
Great premise.
Okay.
Yeah, good show.
Right.
Real clever.
And, like Soupy Sales.
Yeah. Ooh, ow. And the third one, this is a Forrest Gump-like kind of thing. Strange Luck. What's this one about?
Also on Fox. This is about a guy who's strange, sort of like Nowhere Man, but strange things happen to him.
Mm-hmm.
He was in a plane crash a long time ago. He was the only one who survived. And now all of a sudden, he's always in places where strange things happen.
All right.
D.B. Sweeney is the star. It's kind of funny.
Mike Bell.
D.B. Sweeney has been here where strange things happen to him. Let's take a look.
Yes, they did.
Strange Luck.
Things happen to me.
What kind of thing?
Lucky things. Good, bad, doesn't matter. I'm always there. Rescuing people, winning the lottery. If I go into a restaurant, somebody chokes. If I go into a bank, it gets robbed. My car's been in so many wrecks, you'd think it was magnetic.
And you being apprehended standing over a wounded police officer holding her gun, that was just one of those things.
It's the truth.
Ooh.
So we have to watch bad things happen to a good person every week.
Yeah, it's great, though. It's kind of fun, believe it or not. He has a nice humor and wit to him, and it's going to be interesting to see where they take this one. I think it could be a big success. It's on Fox on Friday nights. We're calling that Freaky Friday
Freaky
on Fox.
Freaky Friday. So Strange Luck, I guess you can compare it. It's sort of like Miami Vice meets the Book of Job is the way they're cutting that.
Can I use that in TV Guide next week? That's a great line.
And in 2 weeks, you'll talk Fergie with
you
us?
You betcha.
All right. Janice Kaplan, senior editor.
Yay.
And gadabout around the royal family's extended members.
That's correct, yeah.
From TV Guide. Lori, I understand...
Mario's got to go.
Mario's got to leave.
No, hey. He just arrived.
I know. He's
She's kicked me out. How soon they forget.
But, Jill, I think he's going to come down and say hi to you before he leaves.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
So, as we say goodbye to Marianne Van Peebles, we'll kick off our second hour of breakfast time.
Yay.
It's
finally Friday. Brush off a week's worth of tension and stress and welcome the weekend with family and friends. It does promise to be a weekend filled with sunshine and balmy breezes after all. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer, it's me, Jillian. And now, here's Tom and Lori and Mario.
Mario's getting his shoes on, and please feel free to, you know, you can take this with you, Mario. Just down to the booth, finish it on the way. Lori, whose work is a waitress.
Will you call me?
Yes.
Well, Mario, thank you. Right.
You'll call?
Passing Video Stores, October 17. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Mario,
see you later.
Mario, 20% is usually acceptable in New York.
Yeah.
Here, let's put it over here. Janice! He didn't finish!
Thank you! Terrific.
Half an omelet, we talk royal family.
Put some maple syrup on the omelet?
You do whatever you want. How did Fergie eat hers?
Very carefully.
Very carefully. That's the first thing she's done carefully, apparently, in 10 years.
See, that's big. Fergie's big. That's a guess. Yeah. I'll tell you. That's big.
We've got all kinds of fun stuff. We don't have Fergie, but we've got people who know her real well on this hour.
We have one of her countrymen, Sheena Henkin, our FX therapist, is going to talk to us about holding a grudge and how to get rid of the grudges that you do hold.
I'll never forgive her for this one.
And also, we're going to be talking with one of the stars of Mad About You. Lila Kenzel is here. She plays Helen Hunt's character, Jamie's best friend, and she's being sexed up.
Well, she went through a bad divorce last year. She was really in turmoil, very depressed, but just a very funny woman.
She and Ira apparently are really
You're kidding.
Going at it. They're about to go
at
it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well. And is Edwin McCain here? He's coming in again. He's coming in to visit. His CD is Honor Among Thieves. He's a good buddy of Hootie and the Blowfish, and he's been with us once before.
He's actually launching a tour as of today.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's say hi to our road warriors again around the country. Despite the incredibly inclement weather and the risk to life and limb, John Davis is on Mount Washington, heading up the mountain on a windblown, rain-soaked train. J.D.?
Hey, how you doing, Tom?
Better
Kathy Bedore and I are, I know. We're going to show you how this cog railway is still run the way that it's been running for 126 years. We're going to be from a better vantage point. At least we'll be inside. It's warm and a little drier. And you know, Tom, I love this TV business.
I know
it's
you do.
So glamorous.
Okay. Yeah. Bungee jumping into an oil pit next week. Let's come back here for a sec.
This is great.
We've got
this
Vince
is great.
Giordano and the Nighthawks, a wonderful orchestra here with us today on the show in the ballroom. And later, for the Breakfast Time link, we're going to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the birth of who I think is the best of the silent film comedians.
Buster Keaton.
Buster Keaton. And thank you, Paul Shavelson, noted producer, for pointing out that the train-related Keaton film was The General.
And right thank now, you, Tom Bergeron.
Oh, there he is.
Tom Bergeron, thank you so much. Thanks, Lori.
You're welcome.
It's fun down here, isn't it, Mario?
Very nice.
Mario?
It's very nice.
Mario, can we have a little hug?
Tom's asking if we can have a little hug. I think we can arrange that for you. Tape.
Okay,
now he wants me to go rehearse.
Okay.
All right, thanks, you guys.
All right.
You're welcome.
Remember that $50 that you got for me when you jumped in the pool at that remote a few weeks ago? I want it back for this. All right.
Lots of great stuff coming up, but right now
I'm busy.
A look at some of today's top stories. Close that microphone.
Yeah, really.
Tom, first can I say, what do you mean you don't have Fergie? What am I, chopped liver?
Oh, that's right. Sorry.
All right. Okay. All right. I'll let you go. All right. Here's what's going on with Breakfast Time News. More fallout from the O.J. Simpson verdict. Prosecutor Marcia Clark yesterday slammed jurors for their decision to acquit Simpson. CNN quoted Clark as saying the mostly black jury was swayed by race. The Los Angeles DA's office says Clark was misquoted. Well, planning to start a family? You'd better start pinching those pennies. A new federal report says the average working couple spends 8% of their income on their preschool children. In some sports news, Dallas Cowboys owner Jerry Jones has lassoed another deal behind the NFL's back. Jones made American Express the official credit card of Texas Stadium, even though the league already has an exclusive deal with Visa. This comes just a couple of weeks after the NFL slapped a $300 million lawsuit against Jones for signing exclusive contracts with Nike and Pepsi. And finally, Oprah fans, keep your fingers crossed. The talk show queen is expected to decide today whether or not to pull the plug on her popular show. So we'll have to wait and see. That's what's happening in the news. Now here's Jillian, and is this the new boyfriend, or who is this?
Well, Jane, it's beautiful everywhere in the country. It's sunny, it's balmy, it's bright. The sun is shining everywhere. Let's look at the high temperatures. It feels like 100 in the booth, but maybe it's only 90 in Miami. 80s maybe in Southern California, but it's sizzling hot in here. Thanks, Tom and Lori. Back to you.
Wait a minute, was the camera still down there? Something. Let's see it.
Don't just come back to... Oh,
it's,
yeah,
come on.
Right.
Not appropriate for young viewers.
Oh, okay.
Very funny.
Given that shot, I certainly hope he's left the booth.
No. Do you remember at the top of the show, I talked about how they were running out of names for hurricanes?
Yes.
And I said that they, for some reason, don't use Q, U, W, S, Y, and Z at the beginning of the names because they go in alphabetical order. And we got a fax from Kevin Halstead of Bellevue, Washington, who says the reason they don't use those letters is because there are a limited number of names available with them, so they would run out pretty quickly.
Okay.
And that's why.
Thank you.
That's it.
Thank
and right after, they're going to go to the Greek or Roman alphabet in order to, so the next one, if they run out of names, will be Alpha, Beta, Gamma.
All right.
Omega, Delta.
There you go. All the hurricane lore you need to know and more. We have coming up in our all-musical Breakfast Time Link a tribute to the era of silent movies, particularly the 100th birthday anniversary of Buster Keaton.
Five,
and we have Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks taking us to break.
One, two. One, two.
We're going to be with a JD in Mount Washington, New Hampshire. So stick around on Breakfast. It's 10 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Lori, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer, it's me, Jillian, and now here's the gang.
That's right. We've got the Catcher Grannies from Millis, Massachusetts. We have Al and his wife, Barbara, who's behind me. And Al, well, talk about your snappy dressers, huh? All the way down to the shoes.
Yeah.
Nice stuff.
Yeah.
And you've got your Uncle Tony and Aunt Charlotte from Dayton, New Jersey. Good to have you all here hanging out with Bob. Because now it's time for our Breakfast Time Link. And I'm excited about this one because we're using this little part of the show to celebrate the 100th birth anniversary of Buster Keaton. One of the most inventive, consistently creative of the silent film comedians. We'll go to Mount Washington, New Hampshire for this. And we'll go to Tucson, Arizona, not to talk, but just to look at some of the scenes there and see what happens when Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks put their distinctive silent film era type music to it, how music can really influence the way that you perceive something. Now, to just underscore that, let's get the birthday boy up here first. We're going to show a clip from Buster Keaton's classic Sherlock Jr., which he did in 1924, but we're going to do a little bit of it without music for you. Now, here's the premise. A bad guy has put a ball on a pool table, number 13, that is full of explosives. And Keaton has to shoot around it. First, we'll look at a clip silently from Buster Keaton's Sherlock Jr.
Oh.
All right, so you can appreciate his prowess at the pool table, but you're not getting the full emotional impact of the scene until we re-rack the same shot and go to Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks. Don't hit it, Buster.
One, two.
Thank you.
24. Thanks, guys. Very nice. Very nice. Now, this is all part, by the way, one of the reasons we got the whole gang in here is to celebrate American Movie Classics' third annual Film Preservation Festival, which is going on, Saturday? Yes. On American Movie Classics on AMC. We thank you for that. Now, let's go back to Mount Washington, New Hampshire, and just look at our train, the train that John Davis has been on, the windswept, rain-dampened train. Let's just take that picture, if we can. And is the train going to move for us, or we'll just have the train there, take the shot, and give us, if you would, Vince, sort of a nice, spiritual, calming look at this train. Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks. To be on a train in the fall in New England. That's just, I couldn't wait to get on that train listening to that. Now take the same shot, but 34. Make it look ominous.
Okay, here we go.
One, two, one, two.
After seeing J.D.'s face with that music, I didn't want to get him off the train. He looked like someone who caused trouble on the train. Now, are we going to Tucson? All right, let's go to Tucson, Arizona. Let's take a look at the shot we have there. And this is, by the way, where the personal FX remote is going to be with the super collector of, can you guess, McDonald's memorabilia. Now, can you give us, for this one, this is a clown, so let's swap things around from the way we talked about it earlier. Give us the comic rendition first. All right, clearly here's a clown, it's Ronald McDonald. So give us is that troublesome to go to?
Well,
the
okay. Let's see. Well, we'll give you this. Let's do the show off.
All right.
Kind of play a little clown like. This is for you, Ronald. One, two, one, two.
A Ronald McDonald collector to have that kind of music. But what if, like that bad guy in the Buster Keaton film, there was a bomb being planted in some of these things and he's the guy planting them? This would have more of an action adventure kind of feel, right, Vince?
Kind of an unhappy meal.
Yeah, it's a very, very unhappy meal. All right, here we get a very different look at this McDonald's collector. Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks. Wonderful. Thanks to our remotes in New Hampshire and Tucson, Arizona for playing along. And happy birthday, Buster Keaton, wherever you are. Don't forget, it's AMC's third annual Film Preservation Festival this weekend on the AMC channel. Great stuff.
Thank you.
Good to have you with us.
Thank you.
Lori?
Thank you very much. Edmund McCain joining us for the time on Breakfast Time. We're thrilled to have him here. He's launching his tour today. We're going to be talking to him about that and about his CD and a lot of other great stuff. Rachel?
That's right, Lori. Don't hold on to your grudge. Defy it. Sheena, our FX string, teaches us how to get over it when we come back on Breakfast Time. It's 20 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Lori, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer is me, Jillian. Now here's Sheena, Tom, the Catch-a-Grannies, Lori, and everybody.
Gang here. The Catch a Grannies, our visiting family, Gwen McGee, fresh off the road. Edmund McCain, of course, is going to be playing for us later.
Hey.
And Sheena Hankin, our FX therapist. We're talking about grudges. Holding a grudge can be emotionally draining, but it's also hard to get rid of and to let go of. And Sheena's going to give us a little help with that this morning. Why do people hold grudges to begin with?
Well, let me catch everybody's attention first, like I got Tom's earlier, though, because this segment can improve your sex life, Laurie. Because people who bear...
Wait a second. This is going to improve my segment.
Yes. Yes.
Even you, Bob.
This is going to be one hell of a segment, folks.
That's right. Let me do it. Okay. Two kinds of people bear grudges, and the ones that have the impoverished sex lives. The first kind are the self-centered people. You know the ones who are never wrong? It's always the other guy's fault. Right? Always love to curry all this self-pity from and sympathy from others. They're the real hunter-gatherers of sympathy, you know, how badly treated they were. They're a bit sort of self-centered. The second kind are the passive kind, like my mother-in-law, Lorraine, who fortunately for me cannot watch this show yet. Who will say, you know, when you insult her or do something she doesn't like, she says, you know, thank you for insulting me, have a nice day, never ever complains, never, and secretly, you know, stews away in fury. And never ever expresses her anger directly.
I'm guessing they're both unhealthy.
Both unhealthy, and both punish their partners by withholding.
Really? Even though the grudge isn't with their partner?
They have a grudge habit.
That's interesting.
Two groups of people have a grudge habit. Yeah. They all withhold grudges. Don't express anger, or they're always right. You put those two things together.
Are there any legitimate grudges?
Of course. I mean, what can I say about the Goldman family? Of course.
Yeah.
Of course.
So that's okay, but can they forget even if they don't forgive, really? Can they forgive even if they can't forget?
I think it's important to forgive. I mean, religion teaches us to forgive, and the Pope is here right now, and yeah, he's one of the religions, and it's all the same thing. We have to develop amnesia about the past eventually, but in order to do that, you have to do something about it. If it's a legitimate grudge, you have to take some action to try and change things. And I suspect that's what's going to happen as a result of this difficult week for all of us. But what about these grudges that aren't really that real? You know, the people who don't express themselves directly, then harbor a grudge against you and you don't know why, but they're just not as friendly.
Yeah.
They've got to learn to be honest about their feelings and pretend that human beings, stop pretending human beings are fragile. Human beings want to know the truth. They don't want to be protected from it. And as for the self-centered people, most people that have a problem are involved in that problem. It isn't, you know, it isn't everybody else's fault. You did something. And if you can learn.
Now, Gwen, you wanted to sit in on this segment. You said you hold grudges?
Okay.
Now, look, don't hold a grudge against me. Come on, tell me
it's
the truth.
It's not you, but I'm just saying, most of my grudges are like with show business people, like casting people, and like your talent agent and stuff. They do stuff wrong. And then, you know, you tell them, and then they keep doing it again. And then, I mean, that's a legitimate grudge.
And it had nothing to do with you? Nothing? You didn't do anything wrong?
Misrepresenting me when I'm telling them, you know, why don't you do this way?
Gwen, if you look at that closely, you're going to find something that you contributed to that situation.
Yeah, hiring them as a talent. Well,
maybe this antagonism towards them shows, though. You know, people pick up those emotions. It's really true.
Oh, Sheena.
Come on, Gwen.
I forgive them, but still, people are always doing something to me. You know, I don't do nothing. You know. Shut up,
Tom. I know. I've worked with her for over a year. She doesn't do anything.
Now. It's too self-righteous for me, Gwen. You've got to look at your part in it. You'll learn a lot from doing that.
Yeah.
Besides, I can fix you up with my guy. He's very good.
He got you.
what we're going to do is continue talking about this a bit. And Sheena, I want to ask you a little later about three things that people can really do to get over a grudge and to deal with it. But we're going
to... Yeah, we're going to go to Jane Fergus, because if we get to her too late, boy, we never hear the end of it.
Oh, yeah. She'll never forgive us, yeah.
Actually, I'm a very forgiving person. Thank you very much. Anyway, Pope John Paul is at the Aqueduct Racetrack in New York this morning, and he's leading another outdoor mass in New Jersey last night. The pontiff celebrated mass in the driving rain at Giant Stadium with a record 83,000 people. Well, in some sports news, officials in Germany have questioned tennis star Steffi Graf in connection with her father's tax evasion investigation. You may remember Steffi Graf's father was arrested earlier this year for allegedly failing to report $35 million of his daughter's earnings. And finally, want to buy a hunka-hunka Elvis memorabilia? Well, you better head to Los Angeles this weekend and bring a lot of cash. A huge collection of the King's jewelry, movie souvenirs, and other items are going on the auction block. Among the goods available to the highest bidder, Elvis's 1968 guitar, estimated to be worth up to $70,000. That's a quick look at what's making news this morning. Now here's Jillian with the weather.
Well, Jane, in Minnesota and Wisconsin, upper Michigan, it will be mostly cloudy, windy, and cool, with rain mainly in southern Minnesota and across Wisconsin. In the Dakotas and Nebraska, morning showers in the east and mainly Nebraska, South Dakota. Then skies brightening in the afternoon. Let's take a look at some of the high temperatures. It's going to be 50s. Can you believe that? Around Rapid City, Pierre, places like Jackson Hole, they're going to be in the 50s. Where in Southern California, you're going to see some 80s and also 80s in areas like Florida. So that's going to be the weather for today. Looks pretty nice. Looks like a good weekend coming up.
Thank you very much, Jill. Okay, Sheena, you've been talking to everybody. We sort of continued the discussion during the news and the weather. What are the three things people should really know?
Well, I was speaking to my friend here on the left. The first thing Gwen's got to do is give up the rules that she makes for other people and she thinks they should live by. People don't do it your way. They don't agree with your way necessarily. Accept people the way they are. And the second thing you can do is stop focusing on getting revenge, on getting your own, you know, and getting your own back. Focusing on getting what you want.
That blows Edwin McCain's theory of revenge out the window.
There's some foreigners that deserve some revenge. That I'm clinging to my anger.
And the third thing, I'm
and
saying.
And improve your sex life by forgiving your partner quickly.
Yes! That sounds like a great one. Yeah, get our effects there. Yay!
We have a show every week on FX called Lost and Found, and we've got enough people to spin off a sequel, Found and Retaliated Again. Sheena's segment and advice actually sponsored. How about that for capitalism, huh? We'll be right back after this.
It's 30 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the announcer is me, Jillian. And now here's Tom and a very pretty lady.
Yay!
Layla Kenzel.
Yay!
How would you describe what's been going on since you first walked in here?
Insanity?
Yeah.
Craziness?
Poor woman. We're running around her and just all kinds
this
of things.
This is like a real apartment.
It is like a real apartment.
I'm taking stuff as I'm going.
Are you?
So you know. I got silverware in my pocket.
Can I offer you a puppet? This is Bob.
Oh, please. Yes, Bob.
Bob, I have learned so much about you.
It's either me or Mints on your pillow.
You're so
rich. Oh, man. It's good to be the puppet.
I'm good. I don't have to ask you how you are. You're terrific.
I've lost you already. I've lost control of you.
Wait a second. I'm channeling Groucho Marx here.
We have a crush, I think.
Yeah. I wish I knew.
Yeah. I'm defending your honor, which is more than you ever
have. That's right. Yeah. Let's see you make something out of that.
Yeah. So on Man About You, your character has really started to
evolve,
get real sexy.
She's sexy. She's finally sexy. I'm so excited.
Because this harkens back to some of your earlier roles.
You mean those strippers and hookers?
That's exactly right.
Oh, yes. I did a few of them in my day.
Yeah.
When I was in New York, I was always doing strippers and hookers, and then I moved to L.A., and I'd be... You okay there, Bob?
No, I was just thinking.
Hold on.
I heard him breathing heavy over the strippers and hooker thing.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm glad that she's sort of coming into her own and becoming a real gal.
We have a clip from, I think, the most recent episode that aired with you and Ira in the kitchen, if I'm correct about this clip, and you're kind of putting the moves on each other from Mad About You.
We keep getting involved with the wrong people.
Yeah, how?
We meet somebody and we think we really like them, but we can never really tell because of all the sexual tension. But with my system, you and I have sex, so we're not walking around like landmines. And then if we meet somebody we like, we can take all the time we need and they can suffer.
Well, on paper, it sounds great.
So?
Franny, in real life, it's...
It's what?
You know, you look really good today.
Indeed. I understand that you are the type of person, you're very energetic and easy to talk to, but you cry when you meet famous people?
I do. Yes.
Why?
When I met Garth Brooks. I'm actually crying now. But listen, I've cried twice. I get all excited because I met Garth Brooks.
Just keep your hand on my knee.
Okay.
Fine.
I met Garth Brooks and I, in the middle of the show, in front of all these people, and I started to weep. He took his hat off. And he asked my name again. See, it gets real. And I cried. And then I met Melissa Etheridge this is how uncool I am. I was at Meg Ryan's house for Rosie O'Donnell's shower.
Mm-hmm.
So all these famous people around, and I see Melissa Etheridge, and I'm like, I love you. She's like backing up into the wall, like, who is this lunatic? But I met Paul McCartney yesterday, and I didn't cry.
You didn't cry?
Isn't that weird? He came up to me. I was like, how cool am I?
Yeah. Yeah, you go, girlfriend.
This is a woman who is so cool that when she was in high school, she was the captain of her flag-waving team.
Yes, yay. 2 years in a row.
2 years in a row.
I could wave a flag better than nobody.
Well, so you say, but let's put that to the test. We just happen to have Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks here. Adam has corralled the FX flag. Come on down. You're the one who said
it.
Yay!
Come on.
I need space, though. I need space to do this.
Yeah. Now, we got space.
Now, it's a little bit taller and wider than my other one, but I think I can do it.
What does it take to be a good flag waver in high school?
It takes coordination.
Yeah.
It takes pep.
Yeah.
Flag wave ability.
Well, now, John, you might want to come back here and give Leela plenty of room.
I think you should give me plenty of room because you have to, like, kind of do it over your head.
Is this going
to
be okay?
Yes, everyone? I think so.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Now, wait. It used to have, I just have to make sure that it kind of goes. Okay, so ready?
Is that going
to
be good? Leela Kenzel and Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks. Flag waving extraordinaire.
Oh, wait. And then, wait, I got to go around my head.
We'll be right back with the second half.
And I might.
Yay.
But now I can work back. I did this. I really did this in high school. Hey. How long do I have to do it for?
Another 20 minutes.
I can keep doing it. And we even did like...
Wow, and she's got a good right.
Because I've been working out on my flag here.
I guess so. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
Was wonderful.
Thank you. It was a good surprise.
Stick around. They've got even more music.
All right.
Nice stuff. Laurie?
Thank you so much. We'll be right back with Edwin McCain. And what else, Jill?
Edwin McCain. Very become a regular FX family member, singer, songwriter, and plain old nice guy. Coming up on Breakfast Time. Almost 20 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Lori, Tom, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the Announcer is me, Jillian. Now here's Tom and Leela and Sheena and Lori and everybody.
Is it safe to say, Lori, that there are few, if any, other shows on television where you'll get Edwin McCain sitting next to Vince Giordano of the Nighthawks? And Leela and Sheena. Don't go.
And Bob.
I'm kind of ordinary in this group.
you know, Tom, many shows have tried.
Yes,
you have succeeded.
Now, we're giving the band a break so that they can enjoy your music in a moment. Right now, though, let's find out what's coming up on the rest of the FX stage. Jill?
Coming up today, Tom, on Personal FX, Suzanne Wong is wrapping it up in Tucson, Arizona with a super collector of McDonald's memorabilia. Isn't that right, Suzanne?
That's right, Jillian. 2 all-beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun. Over 7,500 pieces of McDonald's memorabilia coming up later on Personal FX.
Great, Suzanne. I don't know how you remembered all that. And also coming up today on FX is Wonder Woman. Major Steve Trevor is accused of sabotaging a top-secret government mission. Could this be true? Can Wonder Woman prove his innocence? Watch and find out. Also on Mission Impossible today, the IMF turns itself into a surgical team to operate on a tyrannical ruler who has imprisoned the real king, his own twin brother. But best of all, this weekend, the best of Breakfast Time with Tom and Lori and Bob. Watch this weekend for the highlights with your favorite hosts, Tom, Lori, and Bob.
True television oxymoron. Best of Breakfast Time.
The IMF turns themselves into surgeons. Would you want Peter Lupus operating on you?
No, thank you.
No way.
But you know, it is just TV. So glad to have Edwin McCain back in our midst. Everybody all morning that you're starting a tour today, and I was handed this morning thing from the Wires. He's so big he makes the Wires, saying that you go on tour tonight. And then I realized there's a little note saying that was August 11th.
Oh yeah, we've been on tour for the last 3 years.
Yeah.
Everybody goes on tour this week. I'm thinking to myself, well, where have I been? And by the way, there's no more change in the couch than there was last time. Where is the starving musicians fund in this place? I've been taking care of that now. I've been digging through your couches every time I come here. There's no Taco Bell money.
We found Ross Perot going through the furniture.
Okay.
Why do you tour so much?
Well, for one thing, was the only really option we had, you know, as far as being able to support our musical habits and get out. You know, it was the only way to pay the bills was to get out there and play.
Because you don't even have an apartment, do you?
I haven't had a place to live in 2 years, and I sold my car 3 years ago, and now we just do the hotel room thing. But the thing about hotel rooms, if you go and like stick with one chain, it's exactly like having an apartment that's always clean. It's always the same furniture. It's the same, you know, it's the same stuff. And you can convince yourself that it's, you know, that's just my place. Now you like my place. It's always neat and clean. There's always soap and shampoo there, you know.
You know, there's something logical about this.
I'm telling you.
The CD is Honor Among Thieves, and are you going to play a little something for us?
Sure.
That's great.
This is a song called Alive.
Sells records down on Old St. Charlie Street. He's painting up Fat Tuesday's mouth. He keeps the sidewalks neat. And he just lost his father. You know, he just lost his wife. And if it wasn't for the music, he couldn't get on with his life. But he knows what I know. It's not all that hard to survive. You take the good and the bad, and the time in between, it lets us know we're alive, Well, now Bebe's singing gospel, and down on Bourbon she sings the blues. She plays on all my heartstrings, throws my toes up in my shoes. And she knows what I'm after. I chase my dreams with all my might. She says she shouldn't be so anxious, and deep down I know she's right. But she knows what I know. It's not all that hard to survive. You take the good and the bad, and the time in between. Let us know we're alive. We're alive. We're alive. Well, now get on board the rocket. Step right into the front car. You know life's roller coaster. It ain't got no safety bar. Raise your voices up in laughter and bring them in with one big sigh. Consecrated in the wonder, we're alive. Norman, he plays music, but only in my dreams. Shows me all the beauty soulful music brings. Sometimes he's a specter, and I wake up clenched with a fear. The lesson, good or bad, he always keeps me clear. You know what I know. It's not all that hard to.
12 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Lori, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Jim the announcer, it's me, Jillian, and now here's Tom.
Thanks a lot, Jill. By the way, before we go back to JD on Mount Washington, another hand for Edwin McCain.
Yeah!
Mentioned when you meet celebrities, you kind of go a little goofy most of the time. You share the story off the air. Please share it on the air.
We were out at Jones Beach, and we were seeing the Allman Brothers, and I met Warren Haynes, who plays with the Allman Brothers and also has his own solo career. And I was like, okay, there's Warren. Okay, don't dork. Don't dork. Don't dork. And they're going, don't dork. Please don't dork. And he comes walking up, and they introduce me. I'm like, Warren, man, it's so killer me, man. I got all your stuff, and this is my favorite album. And
Yeah, I know how you feel. Kermit blows me away every time I see
him. All right, JD is on a train up a mountain somewhere. The wind's whipping him, the rain's pelting him, and he's on Mount Washington in New Hampshire. John, good morning again.
Good morning, Tom. We're on the Cog Railway, and I want to show you how they operate this thing. Luckily, with the bad weather, we are inside. It's nice and warm and oh, so quiet. Look at this. This is the engine. Well, and unlike most trains, the engine pushes. The engine pushes the train up the mountain. If you look down here, you can see the cogs working, the gear on the track, and that bad boy is pushing us all the way up the mountain. Mount Washington is a very interesting mountain to travel on because it's because of the historical significance and the fact that it's the highest peak in the northeastern part of the United States. And this is Kathy. This is Kathy Badur. She's one of the owners here. And a little bit about Mount Washington. This is a mountain where people love to come up and they want to conquer it. Why is that?
Well, I think that it's a situation where if you can't do it, people want to do it. And ever since the beginning of the 1800s, the elite and the famous have come to this place because it was so remote. They first went up by carriage and by horseback, and then they continued to come up by the cog railway. 1869, they were coming up this train.
And they used to come up on horseback and have parties. So it was like the ultimate tailgate party.
Well.
And as you can see, the weather is not that great right now, but just imagine the view as you're going up this fabulous mountain.
Well,
interesting. This you can see it. Hey, this train is a turn of the century train, and look at the seats. The seats are pitched so that when you're going up the mountain, they're pitched forward, but you're literally sitting straight up.
I
and
like
then
the
they
pitch.
Switch them and they're pitched the other way for when you go back down. One of the first dignitaries to ever ride this train was Ulysses S. Grant in
1869, the year it opened.
He 2 months after you opened.
Yeah. Absolutely. He wanted to be one of the rich and famous to drive this train.
Oh, so now we're one of the rich and famous, and we can go up there. Let's go out front because there's a great view. Actually, it looks like we're getting a break in the weather. We have Kevin out here, and Kevin is one of the brakemen. Now, Kevin, why are we stopped, for one thing?
Robert. Well, we've reached a point where we're checking out the winds and stuff like that. On my way up the mountain, I'm watching the trestle, and the wind conditions, and all that, just to make sure that it's safe for the coach to continue up the mountain.
And what are you watching for when you say watching the track?
Everything, to make sure the rails are okay, our rack that our cog goes into has
to
be fine,
tied to
the wooden structure underneath.
James
I don't want
Gang.
Anything to happen that might stop this coach in a manner that would be unsafe.
And if you look at the trestle, too, the trestle is on top of the ground. It's not dug into the ground at all. It's a 3 mile trestle, is it?
Right. Our trestle is 3 miles long. This way, when they were building the rails to the summit, they didn't have to move any parts of the rock or the mountain. They're able to build it just the way the mountain was.
And you look around, you can see where we're going. There's Mount Washington around there. It's interesting, the extreme weather conditions that they have here. It's always at least 30 degrees colder on the top of Mount Washington. And when you get up there, weather-wise, you're in an Arctic zone. You're above the tree lines, and the conditions are very similar to what you have in the Arctic zone. So that's a look at Mount Washington, and we're on the cog railway. They don't want us to go up too far because the winds are incredible up there. They've had winds in excess of 200 miles an hour at one time.
Wow.
So we're going to stay down here where it's
idea.
Safe.
JD, you've done a good job with all the weather conditions so that you'll be ready next week when we have you do a tea ceremony in a blazing inferno. John Davis on Mount Washington in the Hazard. Good stuff.
Yeah, we'll be right back. Please stay with us.
To go and wrap this whole thing up. Here's Tom Laurie and the whole gang.
Thanks.
Don't forget Mad About You with Lela Kensler.
Yeah.
It's on Sunday.
Yeah.
Everywhere. Mario Von Peebles, Panthers out on video.
October 17th, indeed. And we want to thank everybody else for joining us. Sheena, our visiting family, and of course all our regulars, Gwen and Phil. And thank you, Jill, for doing a great job of this.
Yeah. By the way, Jill, Spencer, and Phil, great fill-in work for Jill this week.
Yeah. Above and beyond.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Next week.
Next, oh, you want to talk? I was going to say John Davis. Want to talk to John?
No, next week.
Okay.
I don't want to talk to John.
All right,
I'm
so
holding a grudge.
I don't want to talk about it. Karen Todd joins us on Monday, and Susan Day will be here as well to talk about a movie season.
And the man out in the midst of all kinds of weather, J.D., on Mount Washington. Nice work, John.
It's a fun trip, the Mount Washington Cog Railway. Great weather, always.
Okay. Personal FX is up next, taking us out, wrapping up our week here on Breakfast Time. Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks. Take it away, Vince.
Indians will meet the Atlanta Braves in the most politically incorrect World Series since the bums from Brooklyn played for the whole Magilla. But no one will argue that they're the two best teams in baseball. And hey, may the best tribe win. Welcome to Breakfast Time with Tom Bergeron, Lori Hibbert, and Bob the Puppet. My name's Jim, and I'm the announcer. Say good morning, Tom.
Good morning, Tom. I wore my World Series celebration tie, by the way, today in special honor of the contenders finally getting lined up to play. You may have seen, Jim, everybody else in the news yesterday, O.J. Simpson's daughter, Sydney, celebrated her 10th birthday. Meanwhile, O.J. was playing golf in Florida. Now, lest you think he's not a loving father, before he left for Florida, he arranged for Mark Furman to plant a gift. So it's all working out. We have a very special guest with us today, Regis Philbin, live with Regis and Kathy Lee, of course, his hit show. But did you know, you can get his CD, Regis Philbin. It's time for Regis. And as I stroll through the apartment to tell you what's coming up in today's Breakfast Time, Rob, hit cut four, would you?
Soul Train!
Ladies and gentlemen, Regis Philbin!
20. How I love you, how I love you, Mom.
We're going to take a look at how CD technology is entering a new age. Keep playing it, yes. We're going to look at the new CD Plus. Not only can you hear the music, but you can get video clips. You can learn all kinds of fascinating things about the artist.
Down by the 20, the folks up north.
The Weiland sisters, Joan and Lydia, are here, and they're going to save your soul. Save your soul.
Wow, who's singing? Burt Ward? Wow.
Swanee, Swanee.
Our road warrior, John Davis, injured his calf recently. And Patricia Moreno, our FX personal trainer, is going to help him with some calf exercises. Play it a little louder, would you?
Don't play it at all, okay?
Among the folks.
Can I tell you, you know what it's like for me?
Oh.
It's like, this is